Stephen, does the recent federal budget affect the projections for the Bank of Canada going forward? Indulge us here for a moment and give us the central banker perspective.
Well, the budget certainly exceeded many people's expectations, I think, Larissa, in the sense that of the fiscal room that was on the table, only about half of it was deployed in new programs. The rest was geared towards reducing the debt to GDP ratio through time a little faster than it otherwise would, which is, I think, a bit of a success given the political situation that we find ourselves in. But that doesn't change the fact that this year and next year, we're still running fairly important deficits, more than 1%, closer to 2% of GDP, at a time when the economy is fully engaged, more than fully, perhaps, excess demand already. So that means that to the extent that the government actually gets that spending out the door, it's adding to those pressures on the economy this year and next. And that's something that I think would be better if it wasn't the case. I would mention, though, at the same time, of course, inflation risk is a demand and a supply issue, as you know. And so some of the things that the government is doing will boost the supply side of the economy. And so there are mitigants in the budget to offset that. That would be the childcare. That would be the increase in immigration, and of course, tweaking the temporary foreign worker program. These are the folks that will take up those, excess vacancies that we have in the labor market, which will take some inflation pressure out of the system.
I want to get into some of the elements and the measures introduced in the budget, but I'd like to touch on the most recent news, of course, with the interest rate hike by the Bank of Canada. The Governor Tiff Macklem recently saying that inflation is running higher than we thought. We need to bring interest rates higher, that the war, Russia's war on Ukraine has introduced a new sense of uncertainty. Help us read between the lines there and understand that language. Is the bank in a precarious position?
Well, the bank is juggling a lot of cross currents, Larissa, in the economy. I've just mentioned a couple with respect to the budget, which mean there's extra demand, but there's also supply measures, which are complicating the outlook for inflation. And then on the war front, that is causing both direct increases in prices, commodities, and so on, but at the same time, causing an uncertainty-related slowdown across the global economy. And it gets bigger the closer you get to Europe, but it's going to affect everybody. So that's a lot of things to juggle. And so the bank would be surely in a very data-dependent situation, watching the indicators very carefully. But that doesn't change the fact that we know interest rates are well below where everybody believes it would be called neutral. And the governor did give more information on that today, an update from the bank on where neutral is. And so I think most people in the markets for sure believe that interest rates will go roughly to neutral as a given, unless there's a profound slowdown in the global economy. So going to neutral means getting up to around 2% or a little above. That's not that far from where we are today, but they still have some work to do. And it's only once we're there that we'll get a sense of whether the economy is finding itself back to a 2% inflation rate, or if the bank feels that the judgment is different from that.
Let's just pick up on a few things that you had mentioned there with respect to the data and that looking at that indicator pie, what's taking up a bigger piece when you look at that right now? Is it the output gap, the labor market? What does that indicator pie look like to you now?
The output gap is very hard to measure at this stage. Always is when there's this much going on in the economy. So for me, the labor market is probably the cleanest indicator that we have. And we are at, of course, at least a 40-year low in unemployment. We have more labor force participation than before the pandemic. So we know we're fully engaged, but we also have close to 1 million vacancies in the job market. And this is because a lot of people have moved up into the, you know, the fast growing part of the economy, and the part that was being shut down now faces a shortage of workers as they reopen. But the good news on this front is, as I mentioned, the tweaking of the temporary foreign worker program, a very important program across a lot of sectors for relieving these kinds of shortfalls in labor. And of course, immigration itself is very strong right now, and the resources have been allocated to the department to help them speed that up even more. So those things, I think, are what we need to watch. It's the same in the United States. There are a lot of job vacancies. And as Jay Powell has said, what he needs to do is get the economy in a place where that number of vacancies goes back down towards normal, which is a far lower level than they are today. And that'll be taking the excess demand out of the labor market. And if there's going to be, you know, an unmooring of inflation expectations, we're going to see that in the labor market.
Tiff Macklem recently saying that that finish line for that rate hike cycle might sit somewhere above that 3%, maybe 3.25%, maybe even 3.5%. Do you think Canada's economy can handle it?
Well, I do, in the sense that it would only be necessary if the economy is still really growing strongly once we get closer to it. That's what I mean by data dependence. You know, as you get closer to your destination, you can see the data more clearly. And I think at this stage, markets believe that, yes, interest rates in both Canada and the United States will go a little bit above what we call neutral in order to put a lid on these inflation pressures and ensure that expectations remain well-founded around 2%. But as I said before, there's a lot entering that picture between now and 18 or months or 24 months from now, when we'll know the outcome, that could cause that calculation to change as we move along. So that's what the essence is of data dependence. You have to, you're going up a flight of stairs, you're going to stop every once in a while, catch your breath, look around, make sure that you know where you are, which floor you're headed for. And I think we shouldn't be presumptuous that we know the answers to these questions. We really don't. We'll have to feel our way up there.
You mentioned that 18-month to 24-month horizon. As you see it, what are some of the biggest headwinds and tailwinds when it comes to our economy, the economic outlook? The last time you and I had spoken, supply chains was dominating that conversation. How do you see that playing out?
So that you raise an excellent example. Let's suppose that the supply chain issues work themselves out sufficiently that actually we get a reversal of some of those price increases that we've seen. Well, then you could have a very rapid and very visible deceleration in inflation, which will help reinforce people's expectations that inflation is going to get back to 2%. If that happens, then of course that will change that dynamic about how aggressive central banks need to be in order to reinforce the inflation expectations. The other thing I think the market may be underestimating right now is the role of QT, quantitative tightening, as it's mostly symbolic, and yet QE was a very important reinforcer of expectations in the crisis and in the early months of the pandemic. And so I think it ought to work the same way on the way up. So now that they're doing QT, that also may really reinforce those 2% inflation expectations. If that happens, then the amount of central bank tightening we observe may be far less than people are expecting right now. That's the kind of zone of ignorance, honestly. We really don't know how that will turn out. And all the things you're mentioning are things that can only help it and actually make it less necessary to wring inflation out of the system, if you like.
Forgive me, I have to ask, is the pace of that QT right on track, or would you alter that somehow?
Well, you know, right now, QT is basically kind of being run as Mother Nature would, you know, to let it run off more or less as the bonds mature. And I think that's as good as any as a way to go, because as I said, I think it's mostly symbolic. there may be on the margin a few basis points on longer yields that you know, rise. And with the added benefit that will also keep the yield curve sloping upwards so that we don't get an inversion of the yield curve and make the market frightened about recessions. I still believe that the window is there for us to have a so-called soft landing, a non-recession scenario that keeps inflation on track. But of course, a lot of things have to go right.
Let's just get back to that federal budget. Of course, we saw some new investments into green economy, infrastructure, housing, and a $15 billion growth fund. What does its success depend on, Stephen?
Well, as usual, these are a great idea in the sense that if you believe it needs a catalyst, you know, and the government is quite open about the extremely large needs in order for us to get to 2050 and to be a growing economy throughout that transition, is going to take a lot higher rates of investment than what we've observed in recent years. I said before that we had 4 years during which the dominant theme in the investment world was NAFTA could get torn up tomorrow. That was the threat that people had to live with. And a lot of that uncertainty is still there. It didn't go away just because of a change in administration. So companies that decided to invest in the United States during that period, you know, those investments are gone. And now they're at a stage, well, should we invest more? Where will we do it, in Canada or the United States? So the idea of that thing is for it to be a catalyst to engage investment here in Canada and be therefore a multiple of that fund is what gets invested here. That's going to take some heavy lifting. You can't just put that up in the window and expect everything to happen, right? It'll require a lot of dialogue. And you've got to make sure that companies not only have that, but have clarity that if they make a 10 or a 20 or a 30 year investment today, it will still be valid 10 years from now, that you aren't asking them to take a shot in the dark. And that requires that we be clearer and increasingly clearer as we go ahead on what 2050 looks like and what the path looks like getting there. And right now, we've got a little clarity with the CCUS package, so that's very helpful. But as we go forward, we'll need more dollops of clarity like that.